We're going to turn now to the latest developments on the deadly coronavirus. 939 cases have been confirmed worldwide, including two here in the U.S. 26 deaths are being blamed on the outbreak. Companies across the globe are scrambling to contain the fallout from the virus. Let's get over to Meg Tirrell. She's back at headquarters with more on what we know at this hour. And Meg, this continues to change. What's the latest?
Rapidly, Courtney. The virus continues to make its way across the globe, with the first two cases in Europe confirmed this afternoon in France. And the second case in the United States was also confirmed by the CDC today, a Chicago resident who had traveled back from Wuhan, China early last week. Overall, the CDC says 63 potential cases have been or are being investigated in 22 states, with 11 found to be negative. For the two confirmed cases here, public health officials are tracking their close contacts and monitoring them for symptoms. They say they do expect potentially more cases in the United States, but say right now they believe the immediate risk to the general public here is low, while noting that the situation is evolving quickly. And we see that in the numbers from China, with totals there and in nearby countries topping 900, up from about 650 yesterday. There have been 26 confirmed deaths. China has also expanded travel restrictions now to 16 cities, overall covering 46 million people. That's more than live in the entire state of California. Now, pharmaceutical companies have confirmed to us they're working quickly on potential treatments and vaccines for the novel virus, though these things can take time to get done. Gilead, Regeneron, and Vir Biotechnology are among companies looking at potential drugs, while Moderna Therapeutics says it's working with the NIH to develop a potential vaccine. But again, these times are months or even years in the making, Court.
And Meg, where is the WHO right now in how they're classifying what's going on with the spread of this virus?
Right now, they have not declared this a global public health emergency. However, they have received some criticism from that from many corners of the world. And they said that they are going to meet again within 10 days. And so we could see them reverse that decision and make that declaration.
Meg, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Well, check out the reaction today on Wall Street. Stocks falling as we got those new numbers on the deadly outbreak. So how much of this is weighing on investor sentiment? I mean, Tim, it feels like more of a sentiment situation here. And when we look back to some of the comparisons, say with the SARS, that happened in 2003, right after we were coming out of a bear market. So things probably a bit more fragile than now, but still it seems to be weighing on the market.
Well, look no further than the bond market, really, which is giving you your clues. You're getting yield curve flattening. You had the Treasury trade, I think, down to 166 today. So obviously all that flows from that. So not only were financials under pressure, but then you also see anything that's related to kind of a reflationary industrial environment. So transports have been getting hit very hard over the last couple of days. So leaving aside idiosyncratic direct exposure in travel, et cetera, you have anything that resembles global kind of industrial growth. Look at oil prices. Look at copper prices this week. So think about the couple weeks we've had, though. All we do is talk about sentiment. So this type of a pullback gives people a reason.
It looked like the market
breath.
Was looking for a reason to pull back, though, this morning. I actually thought about liquidating some things as well. If you look at the mortality rate on this virus, it's about 3%. If you look at SARS, it was about 15%. So I don't think this is a huge... I don't want to belittle the deaths.
Of course.
But I don't think this is a reason to be selling the market. I think it's looking for a reason to be sold.
Totally. But what about some of these stocks, Karen, when you're looking at these casino names that are selling off, some of the entertainment names? We know that in China they are quarantining 46 million people, and closing down Shanghai Disney. They're closing down the movie theaters, transportation. I mean, when does it have a ripple effect to stocks? Or... is this an opportunity?
I think it's an opportunity. I think them being really aggressive in how they tried to quarantine this, I think will work to their benefit, because I really think this will blow over very quickly. I don't think this will turn into a worldwide contagion at all. So for me, I look at, you know, yesterday I bought some Yum China. Today I bought more Yum China. I just think, you know, it's down 11%. And I don't believe that the value of this business has been hit by 11% from this. So there's other, I do think probably some of the gaming names as well, I think, are overdone. So, I mean, it's a little scary and it doesn't feel great to be buying into a virus, right? But I do think that the market has overreacted. And I really agree with Steve. The market has been straight up for I don't know how many weeks now. And so this is a tiny blip of a pullback. And I agree the market was sort of looking for an excuse. we really weren't even down very much considering the run that we've had. It's been extraordinary.
Guy, what do you make of like casino stocks? I mean, Wynn's down 12% in a week. That's a really big move.
But off a move from the lower, from 105 up to 150 was a huge move over a short period of time. So you're right, in that vacuum, it is a big move. But I still think it has further room to the downside. I don't think there's any reason to get in front of Wynn into earnings with these headlines at this point in the market. That doesn't make a lot of sense. And I'll say this. I don't know. Maybe it all does blow over. You hope that it does. But I'll say this. You know, consumer confidence is a very delicate, tenuous thing. And you start seeing people with masks on. You wonder at what point does it start to change consumer behavior and people stop going out and stop going to the movies. And the economy is 73% driven by the consumer. It's very tenuous. And I'll say this again. At Davos, you had people telling you how everything was contained. It's not that now you have it in four or five states.
I totally hear what you're saying, but the more you get exposed to the knowledge of this, like Ebola was frightening for me. That was a frightening episode, and we seemed to go over that speed bump.
Well, the mortality was so much higher.
Oh, 90% mortality rate with Ebola.
Right, right.